Praise to God. We thank God for Pastor Brian Carter, for all the work the Lord is doing through his hands here at the Concord Church. That's my friend and my brother, proud of he and Stephanie Carter and all that God is doing through them. And to all of my preaching partners, Shiloh, it's good to see you. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. John chapter 19. I want to be faithful to my time. If you know the words in John 19, Lord, let the words of our mouth be acceptable in your sight. Verse 26 says that when Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. For moments it is ours to share, I just simply want to talk about all in the family. Will you repeat that after me? All in the family.
In the family.
Have you ever been in church, but church was not in you? Have you ever been in worship, but it appeared as if you were just going through the motions? Have you ever been in a place where it seemed as if you were in church, but it just seemed as if God had been distant? I want you to know that when that has happened, it has not been God's fault, but rather it has been ours. As we look at this text, what we discover as we look in John, the 19th chapter, verses 26 and 27, we discover and unearth that God speaks through the words and the lips of Jesus, who is Christ. He says to John, even while you may have been distant, there's going to be a reconnection in the family. This is the third saying on the cross of Calvary. He's already spoken the first word, and in the position of high priest, he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." That's the word of reconnection, of forgiveness. He's already spoken in the position of king, when he gives authority and sovereignty, when he says, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Now he is speaking the word from the vantage point of the God-man, kind of divine humanity. He is speaking from the position of a son. A. Lewis Patterson Jr. has said that he was so much God that he was all God, but he was so much man that he was all man. When he says, "Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother." These are not the dying gasps of a dying man, but these are the living words of a living God who will live forever. When he speaks these words, we discover it's about moving from redemption to relationship. And right here in this text, we discover, look at the scriptures, there has always been a tension between his flesh and his spirit. And while he is God wrapped in flesh, we discover he remembers he has an assignment from God. And the Bible teaches us that even when he was young, that God wrapped in flesh, they go to him in the temple when they cannot find him, and they're looking for him and they are perplexed, and he says, "Do you not know that I must be about my father's business?" And right here we see in the words of our text that now Jesus, his mother, is at the foot of the cross. I want you to take note of who's conspicuously absent. We know who's present. The enemies of Christ, they are there. Those who have assaulted the name of God through Christ, they're there. We discover that the disciples, they are not present in the text. John is here, but we discover that the siblings are not here. We see here now John has come back to the foot of the cross. And even while he may have been distant, he's come back to the foot of the cross. You are never beyond the reach of God. If I may rush, I want to say to you, the text teaches us in verse 25 that Jesus here, as we see the mother, the earthly mother of Jesus Christ, the Bible says to us that as she is standing there, she's standing. This is an exhibition of strength. That in the midst of seeing her son hanging on the cross of Calvary, pierced in his side, thorn on his head, pierced on his feet, and pierced in his hands, the Bible says that she's looking. I don't know about you, but I could not see my son or my daughter suspended on the cross. He's suspended because he's somewhere between earth and heaven. He's in a strange place, but the Bible teaches us that he sees her. God sees you. God sees you where you are. And the Bible says that as he's looking at his mother, as he's watching and looking at them gamble the garments of our Savior, the tunic or haggling, and I want you to know that some folk are still playing with God. Don't flirt with God's goods. God wants what belongs to him, and yet they are haggling his garments. And as he's looking at the emotion that is on the face of his mother, who perhaps has prepared the tunic early in his manhood, he sees her and he's touched by her emotion, and he says, "Woman, behold your son." This is an act of adoption. Brothers and sisters, you need to know that connected to redemption is responsibility. My time is up, but I want to say to you that whenever you remember that you are saved, don't forget that you are also a steward. Salvation talks about what God has done for us, but stewardship talks about what we are responsible to do for God. We are adopted into the family. Not because we've been worthy, not because we've done everything right, but we are adopted in the family. Even while we don't deserve it, he looks beyond our faults. Yeah. And he sees every one of our needs. Romans 8 and 15 says that we have not been given the spirit of slavery, but we've been adopted into the family of God. I'm reminded of the story of my brother. I see him here today. He told the story today, and I've got to steal it. He told a story about two sisters. One was born in 1 month, and several months later, another was born. And parents, they couldn't have children, and so they adopted this one daughter, and then several months later, the other daughter was born to them. But they kept the one that they adopted, and so one particular day, one of the sisters was crying. She was crying. Bridget was crying. And Johnella was looking and said, "Why are you crying?" She said, "Well, because we went to court today. And I'm crying because I found out that I'm adopted. And it hurts my heart that I'm adopted. It hurts my heart that I'm not a biological child of mama and daddy. I'm adopted." So the other girl, Bridget, began to cry. She said, "What are you crying about?" She said, "I'm crying because you just told me the story. Make a long story short, you told me you're a crack baby. You told me that I know that you're hyperactive. And mama and daddy, I'm your biological child. They had to bring me home. But they chose to adopt you in the midst of your imperfection. They chose in the midst of your ways that they chose to bring you home anyway." And y'all come here for a minute, because all of us, we were born in sin, shaped in iniquity, but there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. But sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilt instead. I'm so glad that I'm adopted into the family of God.